and welcome in today. Today you're joined by me, Daniel, and also JonBoy Meyers.
Hey, what's going on, guys? Thanks for having me, Daniel.
Awesome. It's glad to have you.
You can check. I need to redo my site. I haven't uploaded images in a while, but this will be interesting.
Awesome.
Thanks for having me. Where are you at?
I'm in New Zealand here.
Right on. How are things in New Zealand?
Yeah, it's all good. Here in New Zealand, we are kind of going through the wave of beta. Was it? No, Delta, sorry. Slowly, but we've kind of gone over it now. There is still cases and everything, but yeah, and it's hot in the summer now, slowly getting, you know, hotter as the day goes by, you know. But yeah, it's all good here.
That's cool. Like, we just had Omicron kind of like make landfall here, I think a couple weeks ago, maybe about a week ago, maybe a little bit more than that. So, I'm hoping, they're saying it's not as bad, so, as the Delta variant. So, fingers crossed. So, I'm just watching you work. That's the thing about live stream, Patreon or even on YouTube, you can watch people work, and it's actually quite kind of mesmerizing, almost hypnotic when you watch people work. So,
This stuff's all pre-recorded, so,
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. Cool.
You know.
I feel bad. I was like, oh, yeah, okay. Maybe I should be doing this, thanks. I appreciate you having me on, man. And so what do you want to discuss today, man?
Just chatting with you, asking you a few questions along the way. So if I start off with, can you tell me a bit about yourself to our audience?
I'm JonBoy Meyers. What's going on, everybody? Hello, world. I am a concept and comic book artist, an illustrator, creator. I've been working in comics now for a little more than 26 years, I would say. Also working in games and animation and a little bit of film. So, there's a lot of things I think I'm really good at. There's always new stuff that you're learning every day. When you're surfing the web or meeting new people. You know, I think a lot of people that I'm meeting now are just, especially the young people, are just crushing it in the world of digital. I don't know if it's the reason behind that is because they got the tools when they were younger and better tools. They were able to do more with the technology, or maybe I'm just old. I don't know. One of the two, maybe it's a combination of both, but I'm always really inspired by the amount of art that is training out these days, and the talent is getting younger and younger, which kind of makes me feel a little old. Me on my toes too. So, but that's the nature of technology, though. It increases things tenfold, and you move a lot faster. So what you could have learned in 10 years, maybe working digitally and having better brush sets and things like that, you could probably learn in half that time. But I think with all digital tools, I would always recommend, like, just me being in, this is me putting my old man hat on, try to keep your 2D skills up to par. I found that even when I work in digital, the things that I could do in digital are incredibly hard to replicate sometimes in 2D. You know, that magic brush that you have that blends everything just perfect. You know, in the real world, we don't have those algorithms. We have things like happy accidents and unintended consequences. And sometimes you have to slow it down a little bit and you can't move as fast all the time. So when you're doing traditional. So, but the thing about it is, when you're a working artist, you always want to remember that whatever you can do in the computer, you want to be able to try to replicate in 2D or traditional skills, just for the simple fact that, the event that your computer crashes and you actually have to do real work, you're going to be like, oh man, okay, I gotta draw this by hand and ink it by hand and then go to you know, got to scan it in because my Photoshop is down or my Procreate's down or whatever. Like it's, you know, it can be a little daunting, but you know, if you keep your skills kind of sharp, you know, it's not so bad. Hypothetically speaking. So
yeah.
Freaking out. So like doing all these patches now, like I think I use Photoshop quite a bit, and clip paint is really stable. Sometimes with Photoshop, there's always a lot of patches that you always have to download. It seems like every 2 weeks there's a new patch, so all of a sudden my system will start getting buggy, and I don't know why, and I'll download the patch, and it's fine. It used to be where it was the integrity of the program was a little bit better, so, but, you know, I guess that's kind of how it goes, so.
Yeah, awesome.
I mean, do you have the same problems where you're at when you're working? Because it looks like you're working in Photoshop. So where you're in it and it just freezes on you or it just crashes and you're just like, you're screaming at your computer, this imaginary person, and you're just like, oh.
Yeah.
Fix else, but they can't fix that.
So, yeah. It definitely can. You know, I've had stages where, you know, Photoshop will just have a couple of weeks or, you know, a couple of days where it just crashes every, you know, couple of days, and then there's an update for Photoshop and then something goes wrong. You know, so, you know, I had problems with that, and, you know, with that I just either pause and do something else, like video editing and social media stuff, whatever else I need to do, or just go and sketch some ideas or something, you know. It's always going to crash. Yeah, like you said, having I guess kind of cross compatible skills, you know, skills that you can take to traditional, you can take it right to whatever kind of medium you want to use is really highly important.
Think as a working artist you want that skill set, you know, you want to be able to do that, because in the event that, again, deadlines wait for no man, and if something crashes, you still have to scale. You know, you still have to get it done. I mean, you can't. Nobody in the professional world will accept, at least in my world, won't accept my computer crashed. I can't get this to you. You know, it's like, you know, they're like, well, you're gonna have to find a way. You're gonna have to figure it out, buddy. So, you know, that's kind of how it goes. So.
Yeah, definitely. I wouldn't be able to do what I'm doing now if you know, my computer crashed.
Well, that's the thing. I still probably do it traditionally, I think. It's just it's a different mindset, a different set of tools when you're working like that. You know, I think the computer is very much a useful tool, but you know, if you don't understand light or value, you know, I still have problems with light and value all the time. So I think when it comes to line weight and line work and dynamicism, if that's a word, making a character move is no problem for me. But when it comes to like the color part of it and light and shadow and effects and things like that, these are things that just inherently for me, it just completely slow me down. And I'm just like, oh, you know, that's kind of a weak area where I'm actually going to probably have to carve out more time to watch more tutorials. Because at some point you always want to kind of level up your skill, and if there's something that's kind of lagging, you at some point when you're not quote unquote busy, you want to try to fix up your skill set a little bit and get a better understanding of stuff. Like for me, it's so frustrating in learning new technology because, you know, clip paint is similar to Photoshop, but inherently they are different. You know, they are different programs, they do different things. So and trying to learn one versus the other or do this or do this can sometimes be a little daunting. I mean, like back in the day when it was just, I think, Photoshop, early days of Photoshop, and then Corel Draw. You know, Corel was a big thing, but it was completely, in my opinion, completely different from like Photoshop in terms of what it allowed you to do. I mean, I think that the brushes and the paint blends and stuff like that were a lot better. It's just at the time, it's funny, Photoshop was a lot more stable, so at least for me. Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, it'll be 2 seconds. Right, sorry about that. Right.
No, that's all right.
Anywho, yeah, so I'll go on to a next question here so we can, you know, keep the conversation going.
Yeah,
you know, I was wondering, when did you first start putting your work online, and when did you, you know, start selling it?
Oh gosh, so I really started moving up my, I always had an e-store and I used to sell originals, but it wasn't until this past year and a half, probably like when COVID really hit, is when I actually geared up my web store. And I think I always posted stuff with the advent of blogs and DA, like DeviantArt. It's when I first started posting. I just found DeviantArt, the way you upload things, it's very tedious versus like Facebook or Instagram, where you just click and you do it and it's done for you. Kind of, it's a lot easier. Like for me, I just like, look, I just want to upload this and get back to work, you know. I think I kind of didn't post quite a bit until probably the last, oh man, I'm kind of lame. I didn't start getting an Instagram page until probably, I think, like 3 or 4 years ago, maybe. Let's see, wait, when was I? Maybe 5, 6 years ago. I started, I think, when I was at Ryan. So, because I did it because everyone else in the office was doing it. Like, oh, you should get an Instagram. I was like, for what? But like, well, you just post your art. I was like, well, we can't post art that we're working on here. I'm like, no, your personal art. I'm like, I was like, yeah, I guess I could. So, so I kind of started casually doing it. I'm not big on posting selfies. I'm always just about interested in posting up about art, the art related stuff, because I don't think anybody cares what type of food I'm eating, what I look like, or what my food looks like. You know what I mean? It's just, I think it's more ridiculous. Or me working out. That's kind of a weird one. Like, who cares that you go to the gym? Like, good for you, buddy. Like, nobody wants to see you sweat. Like, you know, it's like, you're, you know, pushing that sweet, sweet weight. You know, it's like, who are you trying to impress? It's like, you're not impressing anybody. Nobody cares. It's like, but when it comes, but for me though, what I care about mostly is art. It's like, hey, look, look what I created, look what I did. That is something inherently, I think, it's something that people instantly respond to. At least I do. You know, when you see great art, you're just like, oh man, in my mind's eye, it makes me want to try to do something better, especially if it's something that's like face melting. You're just like, oh wow, this is pretty awesome. So, so like, let me ask you, so for your process here, like, are, did you sketch this out, or you're just kind of like, just kind of eyeballing everything then?
So I started off with a sketch, as I do. Well, I kind of had the idea I wanted to do like a dragon. And you know, I did something a little bit different to this to start off with. So it's like, just wanted a dragon in front of the castle, of some sort. And then I was like, you know, I haven't done much foreshortening at all, you know, I'm not, you know, so it's like, I definitely wanted a dragon foreshortened towards us, you know, and I was like, I've got to do that. So that's what I did. I was like, okay, so he's going to be, kind of in a way coming at you, looking at you, you know, coming towards us. And as you can see, I've got my reference there. So you know,
that's your mood board.
Yeah, mood board.
Like, okay, cool. Yeah. What I would recommend if it were me, just and you can take it or leave it. Doesn't matter. If you want to push your character more into space, like you've got this really good gate back here, I'd actually take this lower half here of your dragon and push it back into the gate where he is actually in. Half of him is inside the tunnel, like you're pushing the illusion of space a little bit more. So he's actually kind of walking out at you in the, out of the tunnel. That would kind of like push that more into the picture a little bit more. If you wanted to do it, you don't have to, but that way it kind of like merges, like this, the character is more, you're using your background more as more of a storytelling element to where he's not just standing in the bridge, he's coming out of the castle entrance and half of them's already out and he's already, to give you an idea of how long he is, you know, and you see that the other half of him is on the drawbridge coming down at you or in front of the castle at you or whatever. So,
That's cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome. I might look into that in the future, you know.
Oh yeah. Like, I think sometimes that's the thing about art, though. Sometimes when you're in it, sometimes I call it being in the weeds. Sometimes you're working on a piece so much that it's kind of like going nose deaf around something that smells, right?
Mm-hmm.
But then sometimes when you take a step back or look at it from a different angle, then these things kind of pop in your brain, like, oh, you know, if I did this or did that, I could push the piece more. I could push it more into space. In that back space, I could push that a little bit more. I could push that value. It doesn't mean you have to do these things, because, like, that's a good thing about it, is you could always just do a patch and take what you've done and stretch it and put it in there and see how you like it. Don't like it, it's undo. That is the magic of the computer versus, like, doing it traditionally, where you're just, like, you kind of want to know what it is you want before you start, because a lot of painters I know, before starting a piece, would do like little small test pieces here and there to get an idea of what they want, because when they go to working on a final, they kind of want it, the image and the idea pretty free-formed in their mind about what they want to do. But you know, a lot of painters I know would do these small test pieces and say, okay, well, if I did it like this, how would I feel about it if I did it like this? They'll play with the value range. See, that's another nice trick, is when you flip the image and you're like, oh, yeah.
Definitely, you know, just taking some time out every now and again, or just zooming out. I think you would have seen me zoom out a few times. Yeah. You know, there's definitely, in the process of this piece, there was times where, you know, I was just zooming out and being like, what do I want to do with it? You know, where do I want it to go? What needs fixing? You know, what needs changing? Just flipped it, you know, flipping it, seeing what it looks like on the other side and fixing those things.
Yeah, that's, I always do that. Sometimes I'll have one eyeball that looks higher than the other, and I won't notice it until I flip it. And then you flip it, you're like, oh, man. You're like, oh, I can't believe I missed that. But, you know, that's the good thing about the computer. It's a great tool.
You can just flip it, like, you know, all the time. You don't have to just kind of copy it or use a window or something to flip it, or a mirror.
I'm super old man, dude. I don't. I would do a tradition. I just go up to edit, transform, and flip. I don't do hotkeys. I don't do any of that. I just do it, like, traditionally, because in my brain is already working on the problem with the picture, and I don't really. It doesn't have room for, like, you know, a hotkey to do this or do I just, it's too much for me. Cause usually when I work in Photoshop or clip paint, everything takes me twice as long. I'm a lot faster traditionally than I am digitally.
That's awesome.
No, it's not. Sometimes speed, like, I'll get a patch in from my editor, and they're like, hey, we got to do this. So I was like, ah, damn, I got to do a digital patch. So I'll go in and do this. I'm like, okay, put a new layer over, redraw it. Like, okay, and try to get the line art, the stuff to match. I'll break out my digital brushes and then try to get to match the exact ink line art that I put on traditionally. And sometimes it's just removing something or changing something out. It's usually nothing major. I've never had anything where it's like, we need a complete redraw of this character. We need to take him out. I'm just like, what? You're like, we need it in 30 minutes. And you're just like, what? Like, I can't do it.
A lot of people look at it and be like, what? You're like, you know, faster at traditional.
Sometimes it'd just be better if I just put a piece of paper on top, light box, and just draw it, and then scan it in and digitally put it on top, and then do some cleanup around it. That's usually what I end up doing. But if it's something simple, like, it's not that big a deal, I'll just do it digitally. But yeah, like, I can't, just because digital for me doesn't mean it's like it's super fast. It's just not.
Not as fast.
It always mesmerized me, though, when you watch these guys. Like, you ever watch Ross Tran's, you know who Ross Tran is, right?
And, yeah.
Like that guy, he'll take a picture and just like a matter of like, you know, 30 minutes, like you've got this whole, like, you know, he turns himself into Sailor Moon and just like, So, but I mean, that's the thing about it is understanding it. You know what the tool can do and you know how to use the instruments to make it do what you want it to do. Like the world is yours. It's pretty cool. Mm.
Yeah, it's awesome that we have all these tools and It's so open too, you know.
It seems like there's too many tools. It's just like, you know, I don't think all of us know what the capabilities of something, because like, I'm big on books and like there's not really the definitive Photoshop book or Clip Paint Studio book, you know. The really cool ones that I've seen are from Japan, but they're all in Japanese, so I don't read Japanese, so none of that is going to help me, right, in Clip Paint.
Yeah,
but like to do exactly what you wanted to do is like, hey, you know, I need to put in fade, or I want to draw in scales. Like, hey, there's a section on how to paint scales, how to do this. It would be great just to have that, you know. But then you can always Google tutorials too and find that too. So,
Yeah, there's tons and tons of things to learn about. You know, techniques and tools. and I don't think I use like a majority of them. Probably about 30% of, you know, all the tools and all the
Well, I actually bought a lot of tutorials on ArtStation, but I haven't had any time to watch them. Because it comes with the video and all the PDFs and all the stuff that they did, so you can kind of have it and watch it and see what they did. I'm like, ooh, this is so cool. it's just like, it just, again, though, it's like, do you have the time to do it? I just don't have the time.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, it's just, so is this your day job then? You do illustration or?
Unfortunately, at the moment, no.
What is your story? What do you do?
At the moment, I just work in warehousing. And yeah, come home and illustrate and kind of run this YouTube channel.
That's great.
Yeah, so you know, that's what I do. I have been to course, did a 5 years of studying, you know, design school, where I majored in illustration. Yeah, and just been keeping at this YouTube channel, keeping illustrating when I've got the time and most of my week. when I'm home, you know, after everything. But yeah, you know, that's me.
Is Studio Weta in New Zealand, or am I like going crazy?
Yes, Studio Weta. It's an awesome studio that worked on Lord of the Rings and
all of Peter Jackson's stuff, pretty much. It's like anything Peter Jackson.
Yeah, pretty much Peter Jackson. I actually, before Ghost in the Shell was a thing, our class went there and we got to see like a few like sculpt models of before they announced anything to the world about, you know, that they were doing Ghost in the Shell. So it was quite cool. They just like little, it was just a little piece of detail that they're doing Ghost in the Shell. And I was like, oh, they're doing that? What? It was like, I think it was a year or two before they even released that they were doing it. It was like, yeah, it was like, oh my gosh, you know. It was pretty cool. They do, you know, they have worked on some really cool work.
And a lot of good stuff.
And they do let you, they have like a studio tour. You can come and see, you know, what they've been working on, all the, you know, secret artworks and everything like that. We also here have Hobbit Town, which is the Hobbit Town place. I've never been. I do want to go one day. That would be awesome.
That is in your backyard. How dare you? If I were in your position, I would be at Studio Weta all day, like once a week, make a drive, like hold up a sign, retire me. Look, I'll be an intern, I'll get coffee, I'll do whatever. And then just, you know, try to sketch with them, be a sponge, you know, try to, you know. Because, like, I think it, as good as people get working on their own, like there's something about working in studio spaces that are force multipliers for artists, you know. when somebody learns something new, they share it with everybody, or they know a new key or a new brush or a new technique, you know, people learn it and they share it. So those are always the boons of working in a studio or being part of a studio.
Definitely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Being part of a team, we kind of all learn together and grow, and it's awesome. Yeah, because with course I did that, you know, worked with a lot of people and, you know, bouncing off ideas, you know, growing each other, you know, it was great because I'm not too great with writing books because I wrote a kind of my own children's book. And, you know, I was bouncing off the story to some of my fellow work course students. Yeah, and you know, we'd bounce off ideas, I'd give them feedback, they give me feedback. Yeah, it's great to work in that kind of team. I was wondering for you, because you work with an agent, I was wondering, what is it like working with an agent?
It's kind of like, I'm not very good at juggling my time and things like that. And having an agent is somebody who can kind of keep you on point, help you book jobs, help you price your work, help you move your work. Because for me, I'm never a big fan of any of my work. There's one or two pieces I think, oh, that turned out really great. But for me, when I look at it, it's always about the mistakes, you know, or what the piece could have been versus what it is. And with that, it's always kind of I don't know if you know what imposter syndrome is, but it's that self-doubt that in yourself that always creeps in, and you're always kind of, I don't think it's worth that much. And I would always kind of undersell my work, you know? So, but having an agent is somebody who actually understands the market value of what you do and help you price your work and get the most you can for your work and things like that. They also kind of keep you on point and tell you what you need to be doing and things like that. Like, I think one other thing that we've been talking about is actually revamping my site, because I've not been uploading images like I should. I do it on my web store, but I need to revamp the images and things like that, because I want to make it a little bit more e-commerce friendly, because I think at this point people kind of know who I am. I mean, if you're Googling me or looking me up, you probably already know who I am. It doesn't need the whole bio on me, or, you know, my life story, or, you know, how I lost a kidney or anything like that. Nobody needs to know that. But I think having somebody to keep you kind of on point and keep you centered and moving in the right direction is always a good thing, because I think as creatives, it's very easy for us, again, to get lost in the weeds of what we're doing. And like, you know, I have a deadline and it's like, oh, yeah, I have this Batman cover I need to do, but, you know, I really want to do this other cover instead. And, you know, she'll be like, well, you know, this one's due. You know, you've got like 3 days to finish it, so you better get cracking. You know, it's like, yeah, this takes priority. And, you know, I think it's someone who helps you with the business end of stuff, which is always good. You know, that's what you want. You want somebody looking out for you, because sometimes as an artist, there's not many people looking out for you in your interests, and it's always nice to have somebody do that for you. So
definitely. Yeah. It's an awesome thing to have. I mean, thinking of it, I could really use one, but at the moment I have to kind of do it myself. I have to keep myself kind of on point, guide this channel into where it's going, guide what pieces of work I'm going to work on, and where my goals are, and where, you know, what will get me achieving my goals. I've really got to think about that and, keep on my toes about those things. I've kind of got to do all that stuff myself at the moment, you know?
Well, I was doing the same thing. It could be like, don't be discouraged by it. I think once you hit a certain level in your career, then you'll get somebody, and then life will be a lot easier. Like, I didn't have an agent for anything. I mean, I've had art dealers here and there. I wouldn't necessarily say they were very good at all. But when I got an agent, then things kind of changed for me. I think these past, probably, like, I've had one for about 5 years now. who kind of helped me be more e-commerce focused, grow my web store, build out my digital presence and things like that. Like for that, I would have never done that on my own. I would have been like, I don't care. I mean, personally, I don't care about social media too much, but it's an important tool to showcase your work as an artist because you want to show people what you can do where the people are, you know? So, yeah.
Definitely. You know, I do kind of enjoy the kind of roller coaster of it all, of doing all that stuff.
Oh, really? I don't know. Right? Like, Twitter's a cesspool, man. I don't know. You know, it's just like, I'm more about trying to keep it positive and just, you know, like, hey.
Man, definitely. I want to keep it positive, though. Yep.
Yeah. It just, a lot of stuff, like, it's always about clicks, not about people.
So. Mm. But I do, it does take a little time away from, you know, doing actual illustration work, which, it's the reason why, you know, a lot of illustrators, artists do get, you know, kind of agents. But yeah, I get enough time to illustrate to myself at the moment. I'd really love more because, you know, doing all the other stuff. I mean, it does, you know, take a little time away, you know, when I'm not so great at illustrating or creating at the moment. I don't want to create at the moment or something. I can just go do a YouTube video or go do something else that needs to be done, you know. But yeah, you know. Awesome. I was wondering, what has been a project you learned the most from?
I think working in studio, when I was working in games, when I was at Riot, I learned a lot, actually. I think for me, because most of the work that I've done as an artist, it's very solitary. So when you're working around large groups of people, there are different ways to communicate and understanding how different communication styles and things like that. You know, I learned a lot about the business end of things working in games. A lot more. I like to think that I actually grew up, I adulted into the industry by working in games and understanding the personalities that go along with working in projects and collaborating on a large scale. It's not always about the best idea either. So it's about the personality sometimes too. So there's lots of things you have to learn to navigate when you're in those situations, that you just, like, you have this certain idea of what it is when you're working there, and then it's not always exactly what you think it is, you know. Not a bad way, but I think it's just different, you know. So but you know, you're collaborating on a higher level and the playing field's a lot different. So, you know, I think I learned more about the process of thinking about a piece before I approach it, before just doing it. So, you know, there's always a certain science that goes into design and why you're doing things, you know, why things are happening for a certain reason, like why, when you're designing a character, like, you know, why is it so important to understand the narrative for that character, what people are thinking, you know? Because it's, you're always gonna get people who come to you and say, hey, you know, just draw me a monster in here, blah 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 blah, and then you spend all this time drawing a monster, and then people see it and they're like, well, you know, we wanted this or that. And the thing about it is, being an artist, you learn now, it's like, well, you know, you want to ask the right questions, which is like, well, you know, what kind of monster did you have in mind? They're like, well, any monster. I'm like, well, what, a big strong monster, a scary monster, a skinny monster, a hairy monster, a gooey monster, a fish monster, like, what are you guys thinking? Because the thing about it, the more questions you ask from a design point of view, you know, you don't want to be shooting arrows in the dark. You want to be able to define that bullseye for you, you know? So you're not designing in an empty space. You have kind of a sandbox or a playground that you're designing around. So the more questions you ask, like, well, then they're like, well, you know, we want kind of like maybe a reptile, like dragon monster. We want him. Oh yeah, we were thinking maybe he has wings and he blows breath. So you're like, oh, you want something kind of like a dragon? Yeah, like a dragon, but not like a dragon. Like maybe a dragon with feathers or something like that. So you're like, okay, cool. So So you're kind of narrowing the scope of what your design sense is, because they have a certain expectation of what you're going to deliver. So when you're asking more questions and learning these things, then you kind of get a better handle of what they want. Then you can actually create some creature concepts that are more in line with what they're thinking. Instead of showing them 100 different designs that do nothing for them, you're actually centering on two or three designs that probably hit the target for them, you know, and that's what you want, because you never want to be designing or creating in a vacuum. You know, you always want to ask, like, hey, what's the expectation? What are you guys thinking? Okay, you want a creature. What kind of creature do you want? They say, I don't care. Like, stop lying. I know you do. You have something in mind. Like, what are you thinking? And if it's not the stakeholders, then you want to talk to the developers, the people writing the code and designing the place, the character dynamics for the game. Like, you know, okay, well, what's up with this character that you guys want? Like, well, we're trying to... They'll tell you what they're looking for. Like, hey, we want to do something different with the gameplay. We want a character who shoots something at you and hooks you. So I was like, oh, cool. Okay, so when I'm designing this dragon, I'm going to give him like a frog-like element where he can shoot his tongue at you, stick you back into it. Like, that's a design element. That's a beat. So it's little things like that will kind of help you achieve that, like hitting the mark as far as design and what people are thinking. Because then they'll see it like, oh shit, like this is it. This is perfect. Like, this is what we wanted. Like, yeah, something like this, but maybe can we make them, instead of more dragon, let's make them kind of like a really cool looking frog dragon thing. Let's do that. They're like, okay, cool. We can do another iteration and get there. You know, it's just, because you never want to be in a situation where you're just delivering good enough or you're just polishing turds. At that point, you're just kind of like, you know, it's nobody's. You don't want to put people on that. Nobody's happy about that. So it's like, you know, when you talk to people, like, I was just happy with it. It was just okay. Like, I don't know. You know, there's something off about this design. We're not happy with it. You know, that happens quite a bit. It's probably because as a creator or designer, you're not asking the right questions. You need to be probative. You know, you need to talk to more than one person. You know, all those people who are weighing in on your decision have an opinion about what it's supposed to be. And I think you should have those conversations. That way you're not designing, you know, in the dark. You know where that bullseye is kind of at. You want to hit that bullseye as much as you can, or get close to it.
Definitely, you know, having restrictions and limitations and requirements for your artwork, for your creations. This the kind of the way to go. You know, when I was in design school, we had a lot of those requirements, you know. Some of them were pretty open, though. It was like, it might have been design a business. It had to have, you know, this and that. And that was as much as, you know, you got, basically. So, you know, there's open to that, to what kind of business you could create. We had to go through, ask those questions. And I definitely do it, or try to do it the best I can when I'm designing and illustrating stuff, that I ask those questions. You know, if I'm designing a dragon, what kind of dragon would it be? If I'm designing this robot, you know, in this book, or this animal, what would he look like? What would he be doing? You know, I've done creatures in the past and think about, why do they have this? Why do they have that? You know? having all those questions, it's really great to create better design, better illustrations. Awesome.
Well, everything you do, especially in my thing, we're designing the narrative, you know? So if there's already a written narrative or narrative in mind with it, you want to try to, you know, understand what that is and then interpret it into a visual style. You know, of course you want to make it unique. I think that's the thing about it, you know, because, I mean, when you think of dragon, you know, like, you always want to deliver something that's a dragon, that feels dragon-y, but that's something that's your own idea, something that's newer, fresh, or reinvents it a little bit, you know, because, you know, you have your standard dragons all the time, you know what I mean? And there's nothing wrong with that, but I think sometimes when you're creating a new IP or working on something else, like a brand new IP or something like that, you want to we want to add something new to that narrative as far as, okay, well, this is what dragons look like in our world. You know, they're more like this. You know,
yeah.
They're more chimera-ish. They're more mixed with lions, or they're like this or like that, you know. But I think visual style, that always, like for me, just kind of designing and freeform designing sometimes is just not, you know, like I need a space for me. Like, okay, what am I working around? What am I doing? What am I trying to achieve? Like, even with a character, when you're doing, like, I'm doing a character shot, I'm going to try to understand what her personality is. Like, if I'm doing a character like Magic, you know, Ileana Rasputin with the big sword from the X-Men, you know, I want to try to do something that kind of plays up her personality a little bit in the pose and the way she's holding the sword, whether she's really confident or she wants to be sexy or empowering or things like that. These are always things that you want to keep in mind, like, what's your overall feeling that you want to communicate when people are looking at this piece? You know, like, oh wow, she feels really powerful, or she feels very in control, or she feels very playful, or things like that. These are the things that kind of, like, that we can do as artists, that we can inject a certain sense of energy or emotion onto what we're doing, because the point of art is to elicit some sort of emotional response or reaction. And if you're not doing something that creates a reaction, then you're not, in my opinion, you're not doing it right, because you're not grabbing people, then you're not letting them form an opinion or have an emotional response or an attachment to it. You know, you want people to be engaged with what you're doing and to really kind of invest in it, you know. I hope that makes sense. Does that make sense?
Yep, makes perfect sense. Yeah, you know, having, you know, a message behind what you're creating, a story to tell, you know, having something behind it that you can connect to as well. That's always awesome, you know. It's a great feeling to have too, because when I was at a Comic-Con thing, a Armageddon we have here in New Zealand.
Nice.
I had one of my pug painting pieces out, and just a lady coming here being like, oh, you know, my, I was thinking it was like auntie or something, really loves pugs, she would really love this piece. You know, having that connection does, you know, it's great.
Yeah, there's nothing quite like having somebody resonate with a piece of art that you've done, because it feels really good when you get people to really respond to the work that you're doing. It's kind of like, oh, it makes it all worthwhile, because like, oh wow, people get it, or this feels good, or whatever, you know. Oh yes, this is Catwoman.
Yeah, awesome.
Do
you have any anything you'd like to add to the end of this conversation?
No, I think the thing about art is there's no rules to it. I think, you know, I think for me it's always about the mental process going into it. What do you want to achieve with the piece? You know, think about your composition space and what you want to do and what you want to communicate. You know, it's always for me, it always has to have like some sort of sense to it. Like, what am I trying to say, or what am I trying to do? So, or what am I trying to convey, you know? And, did I hit that? Yes or no? Did I come close? And it's always, for me, it's always this weird process of just trying to like do something that I think is cool that people will respond to, you know? So, but sometimes I make it, sometimes I don't, you know, it's always, that's a thing too, is like all this right here is like really old art.
Yeah.
Like, looking at these is like looking at pictures of your ex-girlfriend. You're just like, oh
yeah. God. Yeah. Okay.
But no, it's all right. But the thing about it is it's all a learning process. It's like I can look at that piece like, oh, I remember what I was trying to do, or oh my god, like, yeah, I remember that piece and what I was trying. And there's certain pieces that still, like, I still love. Other ones, I'm just kind of like, oh, so cringe.
Yeah, it's fair enough. I get that too, where I look at old pieces, I'm like, really? But yeah, I can.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing wrong with it. It shows growth on your end. And that means that, that's the thing, is like, if you haven't gotten better, then you're like, oh, okay, then you need to reevaluate your whole process. Like, okay, like, what am I doing wrong here? Like, okay. Because if you're not making improvement, then you're probably not pushing yourself hard enough. So maybe you need to push yourself more, which is fine too. That's okay. I'm not wrong with that.
Awesome. Oh, that's great. It's great having you in. It was awesome. Thanks everyone for joining me, whether you join me on Twitch or YouTube. I will have link in the description for all your art, JonBoy. And thank you. Awesome.
Thanks for having me on. It was a blast talking to you and watching your work, man. Very cool.
Awesome. Yes, it's great seeing your work as well and chatting with you about everything. So keep creating, guys. Keep drawing, and see you in the next video.